ग्रथिताम् पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणीम् भगवतीम् अष्टादशाध्यायिनीम् अम्ब त्वामनुसन्दधामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणीम् नमोऽस्तु ते व्यासविशालबुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दाय तपत्रनेत्र येन त्वया भारततैलपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्नपारिजाताय स्तोत्रवेत्रैकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दोग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्सः सुधीर्भोक्ता दुग्धम् गीतामृतम् महत् वसुदेवसुतम् देवम् कंसचाणूरमर्दनम् देवकी परमानन्दम् कृष्णम् वन्दे जगद्गुरुम् यम् ब्रह्मा वरुणेन्द्र रुद्रमरुतः शृण्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदैः साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदैः गायन्ति यम् सामगाः ध्यानावस्थितदध्रतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यम् योगिनो यस्यान्तन्न विदुःसुरासुरगणाः देवाय तस्मै नमः
Gurubhyo Namaha. We begin with the introduction to chapter 3, and this is the essence of Maharishi's translation to Bhagavad Gita. The second chapter has presented Brahma Vidya, the wisdom of the full life, the wisdom of the absolute and the relative. In both its aspects, theoretical and practical. And this is the Sankhya and Yoga. So here are the two aspects of this Brahma Vidya, theoretical and practical, of the absolute and the relative. The theoretical aspect is called the wisdom of Sankhya, and it brings understanding of the absolute and the relative fields of life as separate one from another. And the practical aspect is called Yoga, and it brings direct experience of these two fields of life in separation. So, we understand that Sankhya gives the theoretical knowledge and Yoga the practical knowledge of the absolute and relative fields of life as separate one from the other. Now, in this third chapter, presents a practical application of the second, what is presented in the second chapter. It describes in detail the role of the established intellect in practical life so as to provide those occupied in the marketplace of the world with a direct way of evolution and eternal liberation. Its teaching is applicable to everyone, whatever his vocation. So, again, the nature of this experience gained through the practice of yoga and its application to life in the world are unfolded in this third chapter. And what is the aim? The aim is to make permanent the state of absolute bliss consciousness, so that it will not be lost even when the mind is engaged in the activity of the relative field. And this alone can give full experience of life, because life is relative and absolute simultaneously. This chapter develops the seed thought contained in the first three words of the verse 48 of the second chapter, and this is Yogastha Kuru Karmani, established in yoga perform action. Again, Yogastha Kuru Karmani, established in yoga perform actions. This doctrine of Karma Yoga, the yoga of action, forms the chapter's main theme. Karma, the action, is in the field of diversity, and yoga is unity. And therefore, to understand Karma Yoga, one must be as familiar with the unity of life as with the field of diversity. One should be at home in both fields, and only then one can understand the link between them. And the teaching of this third chapter, Karma Yoga, is designed to bring this about. Again, it is very important for the student of Karma Yoga to remember that an intellectual understanding of the teaching of this chapter without personal experience of the real nature of unity can never bring the fruits of Karma Yoga. The technique of directly contacting the transcendental divine consciousness, as brought out in verse 45 of the second chapter, has to be practiced only on that basis of the personal experience it is possible to attain fulfillment in life through Karma Yoga. Here, Maharishi emphasizes the practice of transcendental meditation, and it is essential if the wisdom of this chapter is to be put in to practical use. Let us recollect the verse 45 of chapter 2, Sankhya Yoga. Traigunya Vishaya Veda Nistraigunya Bhava Arjuna Nirdvandaha Nityasatvastaha Niryoga Kshemaha Atmavan. And this is the English version translation. The Veda's concern is with the three gunas. Be without the three gunas, O Arjuna, freed from duality, ever firm in purity, independent of possessions, possessed of the self. So this is the effective technique for bringing the mind to a state where all differences dissolve and leave the individual in the state of fulfillment. It is the practical way of converging the many-branched mind into the one-pointedness of the resolute intellect. Now, let us look at the vision of the teaching for this chapter 3, the Karma Yoga. It talks about gaining equanimity, which is the basis of all success and salvation in life. And this is gained and made permanent in two ways, by the path of knowledge and the path of action. It shows how both the paths culture the mind and reorient the functioning of the senses. So by the practice of gaining transcendental consciousness and then engaging in action, the infusion of being into the nature of the mind will enable it to maintain equanimity and sets the senses spontaneously to perform actions which are natural and useful to evolution. This Karma Yoga will remind that through the practice of transcendental consciousness, and when it becomes permanent, the purpose of all action is accomplished. In this state of fulfillment, action that is right must be performed because it brings perfection in life and good to the world. This Karma Yoga teaches how one should be careful of one's actions because others follow one's example. Bhagavan, the Lord of creation himself, remains uninvolved but is engaged in constant activity. So being uninvolved or remaining uninvolved, he is constantly engaged in constant activity. So a man living in the light of God should engage in action, remaining himself uninvolved and inspiring others to perform their natural duty. This Karma Yoga reminds that all actions are performed by the forces of nature. But through ignorance, man takes their authorship upon himself and becomes bound by them. The enlightened man knows the truth and enjoys freedom even while engaged in activity. This Karma Yoga says how important it is for the enlightened man to help to raise the consciousness of the ignorant. So the enlightened man should help to raise the consciousness of the ignorant. The technique for raising consciousness is to surrender all action to God. Control does not accomplish anything because everything is worked out according to nature. So the criteria of right action is not like and dislike about work, but it is the natural duty. Again, the criteria of right action is not on the level of like and dislike, but it should be natural duty. This Karma Yoga further reveals that excitement born of desire and anger is opposed to the practice of gaining equanimity. The seat of desire and anger is in the senses, mind and intellect. By raising awareness about these and becoming established in transcendental consciousness, one becomes capable of spontaneously performing the right action in the state of freedom. When transcendental consciousness is developed to coexist with the waking state of consciousness, then the inner state of no problem or no problems coexist with the outer world of problems. So, even while acting in the field of bondage, man lives in freedom. And this is the glory of path of action as shown in Karma Yoga, this chapter 3. We will continue with the verse 1 onwards tomorrow. Jai Gurudev, Loka Samasta Sukhino Bhavantu.